Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome, my dear brothers and sisters. Ramadan Mubarak to all of you, wherever you are. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu narrated a hadith saying that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna Allah kataba al-hasanat wa-sayyi'at thumma bayyana thalik." Allah has written down the good deeds and the bad ones. Then he explains that. فَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا. He who has intended a good deed and has not done it. كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى عِنْدَهُ حَسَنَةً كَامِلَةً. Allah writes it down with himself as a full good deed. وَإِنْ هَمَّ بِهَا فَعَمِلَهَا. But if he has intended it and has done it, كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ عَشْرَ حَسَنَاتٍ. Then Allah writes it down with himself as 10 good deeds. إلى 700 ضعف, up to 700, إلى أضعاف كثيرة, and many times more. وإن هم بسيئة فلم يعملها. But if he has intended a bad deed and has not done it, كتبها الله عنده حسنة كاملة. Allah writes it down with himself as a full good deed. وإن هم بها فعملها. But if he has intended it and has done it, كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ سَيِّئَةً وَاحِدَةً, then Allah writes it down as one bad deed only. It's amazing, beautiful hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It teaches us how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at our deeds, if it was good or bad. So in this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted two important things, which is the amal itself, with its two kinds, either good or bad, and the intention as well. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam again shows us the importance of the intention as a foundation of the amal, and it shows us the effects of the good intention and the bad intention into the amal itself. So at the first part of the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam talks about a person who intends to do something good. And then at the second part of the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked about a person who intended to do something bad. So in both examples, the one who intended to do something good and the one who intended to do something bad, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this one has two cases. The first case is he intended to do something good, but he doesn't do it. So for any reason, then what will happen with this person? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah will reward him for that intention a full reward, which means as he did that amal. So now if you look at it, there is two things. There is the intention this person did, and then intent, and then the amal, which is the translation of the good intention. The amal is not in our hands as a servants of God. Sometimes we have the ability to do something good, sometimes we don't have. So this is from Allah, the tawfiq, the support, the help of Allah. If Allah supports his servants and permit him to do something good, then he will do it. So basically the good deeds, you don't have a full control over it because you don't have all the time the ability to do it. Such as, for example, you love and you wish to build a masjid for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have that intention, you have that wish inside your heart, but you cannot do it because you don't have the money to build the masjid or to donate for it. So that thing, it's not in your hand. That's from Allah. Allah didn't give you the enough rizq to build a full masjid for him. So the amal is not always in your hand, but the intention, there is no limit for it. So the amal, you are limited by the ability that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how much gave you and how much he allowed you and how much he provided you. But the intention, it's no limit, with no limit. So you can go as far as you wish, as far as you want to do for Allah. So for you as a believer, you will invest with Allah and you will benefit from Allah in the field of your intention more than the field of your amal. Since your intention is not limited and your amal is limited, that means which area that you can do more good deeds with Allah, more benefit from Allah, which is the field of the intention. That will require from you as a believer to focus more in your intention and to build more and invest more with Allah in your intention. The second part, Rasulullah ﷺ said, what about if this person was intent something good and he was able to do it, and he did it? The results of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes that's one single amal as a 10. So every single amal you do, every single good equals 10 right away. So the angels, when they write it in your record here, they don't write it as one, it will be written as 10. The reward right away enters as 10. Now, it doesn't stop up to 10, it goes up to even 70 times, up to 700 times, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And then this 700 times, it's not the limit also, there is also more. Wallahu yudaifu liman yasha. Allah will multiply and give more for whoever Allah wills to give and wishes to give. So that means the limit, when you do the amal, when you intend something good and you translate it into an amal and you do something good, now the reward of your amal, it will become also infinite, which means has no limit as well. Right away it goes up to 10, up to 700, up to unlimited. Allahu yudaifu liman yasha. How much? That's for Allah, for His generosity. So that means when you do something good, there is also big investments with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the second type that Rasulullah ﷺ talked about, that's a person who intend to do something bad, has a bad intention here. So a person sitting and then he decided to have the niyyah to do something wrong. Now, it will be in two ways. Either he will do it or he would not. So if this person intend to do something bad, but he didn't do it for any reason, Allah will reward him for that, not doing that bad deeds, as a full degree. Wow. What did he do? He just hold the evil back. Just holding the evil back, when he intended something bad, it was about to come out to the life. Now, the effects of it, it will leave a big damage. So here, Rasulullah ﷺ told us, if he holds his evil back, then Allah will reward him a full reward for that by holding it back. Now, the second person who intends to do something bad, then he brings it out to life, then Allah will write it down for him as a one sayyi'ah, a one sin only. It will not be multiplied. So this is the justice of Allah, and that is the rahmah of Allah. When you compare between the justice and the rahmah, you will see the rahmah of Allah is way bigger. Inna rahmati sabaqat ghadbi. Inna rahmati wasi'at kulla shay. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So that means for us as believers now, we need to always rely in rahmatullah and work in rahmatullah more than anything else. So here it gives us again this beautiful hadith, the importance of the intention. My dear brothers and sisters, now we are in month of Ramadan, a blessed month. This month is the season of khair, if this is the season of everything good. So now, this is your opportunity to focus again more in your heart, focus on your niyyah, and intend to do something good. I don't understand, what do you lose if you intend in your heart every day to build a masjid for Allah, to build a school for Allah, to build, to help support and families, to do something good, to look after others, any good intention. What do you lose if you intend that? You don't lose anything. So when it comes to the intention, to the reward of Allah, do not look at your hands. Don't say how much I can do, because if you're gonna limit it, you will be limiting your intention with your hands, with your ability. Your ability is limited, that means you are going to limit your intention. Forget about your hands, forget about how much you can do. Just intend for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, Allah, I am going to do Hajj, I am going to go Umrah, and I'm going to help so-and-so families, and I'm going to build the masjid, and I'm going to do this and that. Build your intention. And be sadiq with your intention. Do it with sadiq for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will be rewarded right away for that. So now, no matter if you have the ability to do it or not. So my point again here, during this month of Ramadan, try to increase your good intention to do good stuff for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then see how much you can do, and then go as max as you can. See how much Allah made you able to do, then do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, Allah benefit us from this blessed month and give us the reward of the good intention and the reward of the good amal all the time. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان، فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصمه، ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر، يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر، ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون.
بسم الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Welcome back to our youth segment. I welcome all the youth, the parents and the family, the friends who are tuned into this program at the moment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with lots of goodness and accept all of your good deeds and make this Ramadan easy for you. As the past day or two of Ramadan has passed, we've probably started to experience the fast and experience the difficulty of it. And it's fair to say that the first few fasts, because we're not used to fasting, are definitely challenging and difficult, especially in the morning when we wake up and we wake up with a dry mouth. And the first thing we think of doing is drinking water, but then we're reminded suddenly that, you know, we can't drink water. And then we're reminded that, wow, every single time that we got thirsty in the remaining months of the year, the 11 months, we had the luxury of being able to sip on that water and make that thirst go away instantly. But now, in this blessed and holy month of Ramadan, for the sake of Allah, we choose to not have that luxury. And we only do this for His sake. And throughout the day, when that little bit of thirst and that little bit of hunger hit us, we were so used to, in the rest of the year, being able to eat at our disposal whenever we wanted and make that hunger go away. But now we choose not to, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked us to, and we love Him so much. So now, moving on and continuing from where I left off in the last youth segment, I just want to point something out to the parents and the family members, the elders that are, you know, taking part in this segment, that when we hear advice from khatibs, when we hear it from lecturers in speeches and videos like this, and it's addressing the youth or somebody else like our spouse, our brother or our sister, we're not supposed to be using this type of message to point fingers at them, right? We're not gonna show them the video and then look at them and point fingers and be like, Beta, see, they're talking about you, right? You should be listening to what this man is saying because you waste your time, or you don't fast properly, or you don't read Quran. Like, that's not the point of this video. That's not the point of any of the messages that are sent. And we're all in need of this type of advice and the attitude to try our best to do the best we can. So I just hope and pray that everyone understands that aspect of all of these reminders and these segments. Now, moving on to what type of things you and I can do during the month of Ramadan to make the most of it. We've been given this blessed month of Ramadan, and it's a blessing. It always is a blessing, and there is goodness in it at all times. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to extract all of the blessings from this month. So I want to direct this attention to the people that don't have school or work and they're at home. And obviously, if your parents are working, they don't have as much time as you and I do, the youth, or whoever it is that is not working and they're at home. So naturally, we have more time at home to make the most out of this Ramadan. So obviously, we should be keeping ourselves busy in the pleasure of Allah and make as much use of it. So a few things that I wanted to say in regards to that is, one, in the beginning, the first few days of Ramadan feel very, very long. And in the beginning, we tend to, you know, waste our time and do things just to get to the end of the day when it sunsets and we can break our fast and eat, just to make the days go by. And then we keep doing this in the first maybe 5-10 days of Ramadan. Then it hits us that, wow, we're almost, you know, halfway through Ramadan. Maybe I should actually get my act together and actually feel spiritually uplifted. So we want to realize that before it's too late. And this month goes by really, really quickly, right? So let's not try to just blow by it and be done with it, because there's benefit to it. Even if we didn't come into this month prepared, like myself, to be honest with you, this month came so suddenly and I didn't feel like I was prepared. And now we're in it and you're not the only ones. We have to basically understand that this month's going to blow by very easily. For the people that are staying at home, some of the things that we can do is help out with suhoor and iftar, which is sehri and iftari, which is the two times and the crucial important times of the day that we get to eat. And our job should be, if we're not the primary cookers of the house, whether it's the mothers, the wives, the sisters, whoever's cooking at that time, we should, if we're not predominantly cooking, we should be helping them or assisting them an hour before iftari for sure. And for suhoor and sehri, we should try to wake up as early as them or wake up a little bit early, to the point where we're not coming down, you know, 30 minutes, 20 minutes, 15 minutes before, you know, Salatul Fajr, before the fast starts, and just being coming down like zombies and doing nothing and having a plate of food ready for us. We just eat it and then we leave. That's not the intention here. That's not what we should be trying to do. We should be trying to do more than that. We should be trying to help and assist as much as we can. And inshallah, we will take a huge portion of goodness from the fasting people of our family that eat the food that we help cook. And a few things that we can do in trying to help is simple things like getting water for everybody, simple things like setting the plates, the dinner table, taking out food for our mother, our father, things like that. And same thing with iftar, is help with the meal prep and just the preparation of the dinner table. It takes a huge toll on the mothers, on the sisters, and on the wives. So let's try our best as children, as husbands, as brothers, to help them as much as we can, so it's not a difficult and stressful time. Because I know, you know, like I've seen it, and I know I'm not the only one that sees it. I'm sure every household experiences a mother or a sister or a wife that just loses their mind in the month of Ramadan, in suhoor time and iftar time, trying to prepare food for everybody. Like it's not easy, right? And they deserve a lot more recognition than we give them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of their good deeds and all of the efforts that they put to feed our hungry bellies. With that, I conclude until next time, inshallah. May Allah give us the ability to apply the good that has been said. And until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Please take the wonderful opportunity this month to sponsor the Noon Academy Iftar program. Please contact us for details. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakat. In today's history segment, we will continue talking about Ahmad ibn Fadlan, part 2. Last time, we learned about the scholar's endeavors in Russia and how he served the Muslim world in the Abbasid-sponsored envoy. He taught the Volga Bulgars Islam in 922 AD, and it was said that he arrived to the town of Bulgar on May 21st. The people of Tatarstan celebrate the arrival of Islam annually on May 21st. They even built monuments celebrating this day. Today, despite many trials the Tatar Muslims faced, from Ivan the Terrible's forced de-Islamization of Russia, to the Soviet Communist agenda of eliminating religion from their union, which, by the way, also including uprooting the Arabic script the Tatars used, the progeny of the Bulgars of 922 are still proud Muslims today. This year, they are lucky enough to have the celebration of the arrival of Islam in the last days of Ramadan, May 21st. In modern times, they have hundreds of mosques, an Islamic university, and are quite active within the international Muslim community. Moreover, Ibn Fadlan exposed Islam to the Volga Vikings and discovered lucrative trade routes for the Muslim world to use. However, what is most incredible about this story is about how Ibn Fadlan single-handedly preserved the history of the Vikings of the Volga. European accounts are inaccurate and strongly hold an unfavorable attitude towards the Vikings as they are historical known enemies. Muslim accounts have always been more objective, and Ibn Fadlan's 10th century account is exceptionally credible. Even the Norsemen of the Volga never left behind any reliable history dating before the 12th century, and most of it can be deemed folklore. Ibn Fadlan is most famous for recording the funeral proceedings of a Viking chieftain with impressive attention to detail. The thing is, the Vikings only had a runic alphabet suited for no more than inscribing gravestones and placemakers. They were hardly even in a position to write their own history. It is very possible the Muslims even preserved their Nordic polytheistic beliefs. In fact, Ibn Fadlan is the only one to record about the tattooing customs of the early Vikings, thus making it a historic fact, not just folklore. F. Donald Logan, a historian who studied in the University of Toronto, specializing in medieval times, states in his book, The Vikings in History, and I paraphrase, "There is no witness of the Vikings anywhere or at any stage that provides more detail or a more vivid account than Ibn Fadlan. Its accuracy is uncontested and its importance obvious." Just as a comparison, the Norwegian accounts of their own Vikings were written long after events took place, meaning their sources are not even valid historical documents. Moreover, Ibn Fadlan's chronicles were used to confirm archaeological findings. Modern archaeologists have found hundreds of thousands of Abbasid dirhams in the graves of Vikings. And Ibn Fadlan's account of Viking history explains why there's so much foreign currency associated with them. According to Thomas Noonan, one of the leading experts of medieval Scandinavian relations with the Muslim world, states that the Abbasid coin helped fuel the Viking age. In fact, the Rus fully adopted the Abbasid dirham as their currency. In fact, archaeologists found more than 100,000 Abbasid dirhams buried in Sweden alone. Ibn Fadlan is proof of the keen and literate observers of the Abbasid Empire. At his time, he served his caliph well by bringing new lucrative trade routes to the Islamic Empire and securing an alliance with the Volga Bulgars. Moreover, he brought Islam to the people of the north, and their descendants live in these areas until this day. Now, Ibn Fadlan's work is used as a crucial historical primary source used to uncover the history and culture of the old Vikings, specifically around the Volga, and Scandinavian culture is indebted to him. There are many Muslim accounts of Vikings in other areas and times, such as the accounts of Al-Tartushi, Al-Mas'idi, Al-Muqaddisi, and most famously, Ahmed ibn Rusta, who are all trailblazers in the study of geography, and all their works were translated into European languages later on. Conversely, Ibn Fadlan's Risala was lost for centuries, and only fragments of it are known to us today. Interestingly, with these fragmented articles, Ibn Fadlan was heavily featured in the 1999 Disney movie, The 13th Warrior. Moreover, his work was greatly used in the American novel, Eaters of the Dead, which is supposed to be a historical fiction. However, Ibn Fadlan's depiction in these works are horrendous representations of his character, but it actually referenced a lot of his works, at least. However, Ibn Fadlan's work was saved by another person, and without him, we would have never known about him or his legacy. Tune in next time to hear about how the Muslim geographer Yuqat al-Hamawi preserved Ibn Fadlan's sole surviving work, the Risala, over 300 years after it was written.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad, Allahus Samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ ومن شر النفاثات في العقد ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا